Lucia from Ubuhle Shange. She says, I would like to say I love you so much, Rosie.
Oh, wow.
Talking to you, finding your posts on social media really changed my life. Today, I'm a qualified teacher, but before all of that, I never knew what would happen, right? You gave me hope. I still treasure the moment I walked into Gateway Hotel to fetch a gift you had left for me. Keep on being a
rock. Oh, my gosh, I know who you're talking about. Oh, wow. Yay! Thank you, Buhle. Oh, wow. I remember that very, very well.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I got this message around like 10 to 6, yeah. And I read it and I was just like, wow.
Wow.
What a way to start away.
That, absolutely. That's a beautiful way to start an evening. Thank you so much, Buhle.
So, shout out to you. What does it mean to you to know that you have, you actually leave this kind of mark on people?
You know, it means that as difficult, some days are really difficult because our job is not easy, you know.
Definitely.
And I know with social media, everyone's like, yeah, we're on Flick, everything is fantastic, but you know, but you know, the fact that if you can touch, and this is one of my goals, and it was actually one of the reasons why I stopped working on Generations, was that I felt that if I could touch one person at least once a month or at least once a week, then, and I know that my purpose on earth is en route to being fulfilled.
Yeah.
You know, and so messages like that, that if I can impart that, and impart something and instill something in somebody's heart or mind or feeling, or just even for that 2 minutes of that day,
yeah.
It's all worthwhile.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when did you saying, you know, I'm good being on screen, I'm good being on the silver screen, and you now wanting to represent people, when did this journey all start for you, and why did you take this journey?
I always believed, like even when I was starting the industry, was that as actors, and well, back then even, and even now, we aren't really respected 100%.
Mm-hmm.
Number two is that we're not really remunerated on the level that we should be.
Definitely.
I know I'm going to get lambasted from all left brands and from different producers, and I don't care. I'm going to tell it like it is. But also, we're not protected. So we're not protected in terms of a lot of insurance policies, not protected. I mean, we freelance personnel, so we majority work without medical aid because it's way too expensive.
Yes.
All of those different things. So I just felt that I needed to tap into as much of the industry as possible before I throw in the towel.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of them was, while I was in Studio 53, I noticed that there weren't female producers. And so I trained as a producer. And every day that I went onto set, whether it was on location or studio, I would constantly watch the director in charge and ask questions. Why are you putting the camera there? Why did you make me do this? All these type of questions so that I can then move into that role. So part of Studio 50 was that. And then while I was traveling the continent, people would say to me, you know, you've been in the industry for a while. Could you help me set up this contract, or how do I handle this deal, or what do I do for this? And that's when I realized, I was like, wait a minute, I can impart my knowledge, number one, training, and that's where my TV presenting training and acting workshops came about. And then the so-called management was more worked on a favor basis. And then when I work about, I was like, wait a minute, this is an extra job. I enjoy doing it.
Okay.
So that's when I decided, okay, let me start my agency. And I did a bit of research, and there was nobody at the time that was representing talent from across the
continent,
you know, on the level that I was doing. And that's when I sat down and I started to research names for my company. And I kept on putting into the search engine Shine, Sparkle, Talent, that type of thing. And Waka kept on coming out.
Waka.
And the true meaning of Waka is shine in Swahili. But it's actually, if you're looking at a fire and that little spark that goes off into the air disappears, that's known as Waka. So that's when I was like, okay, my baby's born.
That's an inspirational name. That's a beautiful name.
Yeah.
And your first clients, like, how did things go, like, with your first
My first clients. I mean, I just recruited all my guys from Studio. I'm like, guys, no, it's time. Let's just cash in here.
Yeah.
So it was that. And then when I realized the footprint that I was making into Africa was when I got a call from Mr. Chris Arthur, who is an award-winning actor from Ghana. At the time, he was in the Nigerian soapy called Tinsel. And he was like, this is who I am. Let me explain. I was like, whoa, I know who you are. You're Mr. Chris Arthur. He was like, would you be consider representing me? And I was like, what?
Yes.
And at the time, I mean, I didn't even have an office. I was working from home. So I went to meet him. Incredibly, incredibly nervous. Met him. We sat down, negotiated. I gave him the contract, all of that. And then I signed him on to that. So that was my first client, per se, that came outside of the Studio 53 family. And then from there on, it was just every time I travel, people were like, oh no, you're the South African manager. Would you be considering managing me? This is who I am. I have turned down a lot of clientele because one of the two criteria which I don't fall into is that it's music and it's modeling.
Okay.
Purely because I've never been a musician. You do not want to hear me sing. And I've never been a model. So for me to impart any knowledge or give advice or manage, I need to be able to have worked in that space. So
yeah.
I've worked in the space of TV, film, speaking, emceeing, brand ambassador, all of that.
Yeah.
And then my first casting gig came from Mnet, and they needed to cast characters from Kenya and Ghana. So we went on a tour through Kenya, through Ghana, and we cast the characters for the Tinsel Soap. And
so West Africa.
Yeah,
East Africa,
and East Africa merging. And then that's when, I mean, I got to meet Patrice Jua, who is a phenomenal personnel from Liberia. I got to meet the award-winning actress Lydia Forson, who is now my kindred sister. It's weird. We like the one day I rocked up in Nigeria, and then I hear this voice standing behind me at reception, and we were so excited to see each other. It was like, and people were like, what's wrong? We were like, you know, just excitement. So
yeah.
From then on, it was just about word of mouth and just spreading it out. Yeah.
So I see with Waka, you're actually really taking, well, the rest of Africa to the rest of Africa.
Yeah.
And what I'm seeing a lot lately, right, is that Africa is really coming a lot to South Africa.
Yeah.
And I feel like South Africans are a little afraid to go to the rest of Africa.
Yeah.
Like, how do you think we'll be able to change that? Because luckily for me, like, I'm a mixed baby.
Yeah.
So my dad's from Zimbabwe, and I also have roots in Botswana.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm I'm open like that.
Yeah.
But there's some of us who are just like, no, South Africa.
Yeah.
That's it. No.
Well, you just hit the nail in the head, and that's it. You need to be open.
Yeah.
I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say it loud, and it's going to offend people. But South Africans, you need to get over yourselves.
Thank you.
Get over yourselves. You know, you've got this thing that, oh, we're South African, we're elite, all of this nonsense, rubbish.
Mm.
I've been at the borders of certain countries where I've seen South Africans going over, and I've been embarrassed to be carrying that green passport purely on the way we treat people at the borders. Yes, South African, certain parts of infrastructure may be advanced, but education, if you go to Zimbabwe,
yeah.
The education system is much higher than
yes.
the average education system in South Africa. So if you want to go on that pathetic ideology that South Africa is more superior than the rest of Africa, then I think you need to look at the intellectual aspect, because Nigeria is exceeding us, Zimbabwe is exceeding us. Yes, we have fantastic intellectuals and fantastic schools in South Africa, but if you cross the continent, you will be mesmerized. And you need to go in with that open mind, because if you're going to go in with a closed heart, you're going to be met with a closed heart. You know, I lived in Uganda. Yes, I had problems in terms of the company that I was working with, but I would have had those problems anywhere else.
Yeah.
You know, that was corporate Uganda, and I would have had those type of problems in corporate South Africa. So advice to South Africans across the border is get over yourself, get rid of that chip on your shoulder, and open your minds. Because once you do that, and once you embrace it, it is a phenomenal journey. Phenomenal.
Yeah. So, like, we need to start seeing ourselves as Africans first before we see ourselves as South
yes,
Africans.
Yes, or, like, going into deep, dark Africa. And educate yourself. You know, the amount of times that people say to me, well, do you have to carry your water across the border? No.
Oh.
You buy bottled water in most places, like you do in South
Africa.
They have hotel groups. They have cars. They, you know what I mean? It's just, come on.
You sound
come on.
Very American. That sounds very American.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So
it's on that level, and infrastructure is beautiful. The architecture in most of the places is absolutely phenomenal. And then, you know, the breathtaking sunsets. It's just remarkable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe, like, I don't know. Like, I feel people are just really unnecessarily scared. And it's just like it's a chip on the shoulder that they genuinely need to, like, just get off. Because I know I've been met with quite a number of people just like, how does that work? I'm just like, wow, my parents went. No, one is from Zimbabwe, one is from South Africa.
But you see, the thing is, that's also, as South Africans, is why are we constantly defining ourselves?
That's another
We're
thing.
Africans.
Yeah.
You know, and I look forward to the day where we don't have to cross borders with visas.
I
look forward to the day where there's a pan-African currency.
Yeah.
You know, I think it still happens, but the last time we used to fly to Kenya, you didn't need a visa to get into Kenya. You know,
we have a lot of privileges in South Africa, actually in Africa,
we do.
In terms of not having to get visas for quite a number of countries.
Yeah.
So it makes no sense to me for someone not to want to see the rest of their continent.
Absolutely.
Like, why not start off in Southern Africa?
Yeah.
And then travel
and
then, out.
And if you're too scared, okay, so then maybe step outside of Sandton. And, you know, there's a bit of a small country called Swaziland, which has got a new name by now. So.
Eswatini.
Eswatini. There's another one, Lesotho. You know, I did last year, one of my artists from Botswana had his book launched, Donald Molosi. And I was staying in Pogeng with my mom. So I thought, you know, it's silly for me to drive all the way to Joburg and catch a flight where there's a bus that goes through. And it was the best experience of my life because you're driving through the day. So I got to see another part of the country that I'd never, ever experienced. It's literally, well, from Rustenburg side, it's about like another like 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah, it is.
On a very luxury bus. And so explore, do that, you know. And when you get there, word of advice is that, you know your security, know your surroundings and so forth, but make friends with the locals.
Amen.
You know, because I've been invited to people's homes. I've been to people's weddings that I didn't know, just to experience other cultures, you know. And when you go there, it's not about sitting in your hotel room and watching CNN or whatever's on their local stations or whatever. Go out, take a walk, try the local cuisine. Find out about the history. You know, it's just remarkable, and you'll be surprised about the so much of the similarities that happen across.
We are so intertwined.
Yeah, you know, I mean, when I was living in Uganda, I unfortunately don't speak Zulu, but apparently Lugandans, when they were in South Africa, they could understand a lot of Zulu.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. So there's definitely obviously there's that link that crosses over, but. But as South Africans, everyone's like, ooh, no, let me stay behind my high walls. I've got my AVT. I've got all of that. No, move.
Ooh,
let's go.
Explore.
Yeah.
29 and a half minutes after the hour of 6 p.m. CAT on Trans Africa Radio. This is Girls Gone Wild. Who I am with you to 8 p.m. Central African Time. Yo, like, this timing is killing me because I'm so used to 2 to 5. Now it's 5 to 8 p.m. CAT. But do remember, we want to hear from you. +27.